sponsors.
And so now it's 74 days since LaMelo Parker was killed in the middle of our 10 on in Biloxi there, folks. There's been some movement. I mean, you might can kind of hear there has been some movement. I'm not at liberty to go into any kind of details at this point. The Biloxi PD is doing the investigation. It is being overseen by the district attorney of Harrison County. Harrison Hancock, actually. By the way, he was appointed, bro. He has not run for election yet, Parker, district attorney. I don't know whether he will. All eyes on you, bro. And I'm sure you're going to do a good job. This is should end up in a before a grand jury. It could have already. We are not getting that information. Not exactly. The determination here is how it is that you had a double homicide and whether it was a justifiable shooter. Bo Smith, who is the father, I use that term loosely, of LaMelo. It is a homicide. It was police-involved shooting. And so therefore, typically a grand jury will do that evaluation. I don't know whether or not the DA has within his discretion to determine otherwise. Some have said he does. I would hope that a grand jury would take a look at the facts. And so we'll let you know. One thing's for sure, we owe you, the American society, the Mississippi society, go for it. Biloxi Society at least an explanation as how a four-month-old was killed while over 50 officers surrounded him. There's got to be an explanation. Not only that, there has to be an explanation as to why some 30-some-odd shots were fired into that vehicle. Just saying. There's an explanation for everything else. I don't think we're that far away. It's just that right now, folks, let me just tell you, there are real live people who are doing these investigations and handling the paperwork. And there's some of you, and I know some of you are listening to me, some of you put your jobs over the human beings that's being shuffled by that paper. You know what I mean? In other words, you're going to hear a story here very shortly that is just unconscionable. And anyone who is thinking of another person as another person would not do this. You know, it puts me back to when my father got gravely ill and was applying for Social Security, and I shared this with you before. And for those of you who have applied for Social Security, trust me, I know you've gone through the paperwork and you know what I'm talking about, but it was far more horrendous then because you didn't have computers, right? So it was literally shuffling papers, and some lowly little attendant has claims piled up on her desk. And they're going to be there the next day, and they continually pile, and not enough people to handle all the cases. I knew that. I understood that. I was patient for a while. Until it became more than evident that, you know, my father was being shuffled around. Even I was being shuffled around. I took on the responsibility of trying to make the phone calls and do the due diligence and help out and provide the information and find out where my daddy's file was. And it was lost on several occasions. I mean, we went through almost 9 months, bro, with this. All the time, my father was incapable of working and still going to the doctor. Here, now, what was helpful was that he's a VA. He's a veteran, and so therefore he could go to the VA. What was not as helpful was the mere fact that there was no revenue. I'm in college at the time, handling this at a distance. So it wasn't until I actually had to corner some lowly supervisor of a clerk or clerks to really let them know that I knew their entire name and had done the necessary due diligence to find out who they were. Yeah, you might call it a threat. It wasn't that. It was actually a promise. And upon sharing that with him, upon him realizing that, okay, well, you know, just as my father's a human being, so are you. You have your frailties as well. And I'm not going to let my daddy, represented by paperwork sitting on your desk, sit here and rot. That ain't going to happen. He understood. I would not advise anyone else to do that. It was effective then. It may not be effective later on. Before the phone conversation was over, he had finally went down that stack, that very large stack, after explaining to me what and why. I said, look, I've got him right here. What helped was the mere fact that he understood, he saw that my father was also a veteran. That pushed him to the top of the pile. Between that and our now being on a very personal rapport. Because I knew where he was, where he lived, what his entire name was. I took the opportunity in LexisNexis with a friend of mine there in St. Petersburg, Florida, and wanted him to know that I know. However, we got off the phone amicable. Which makes me tell my point. The point is that we've got folks, unfortunately, low-level individuals who are just shuffling papers, be it with Social Security or be it, in this case, with a case like LaMelo or anybody else for that matter, or a case like guy by a young man by the name of Jones, AJ they called him, Arthur Jones. It's kind of shuffling papers. This is all part of my job. I'm just trying to do my job. Garbage in, garbage out. Says right here, file B, section 9. Now, I know that what you're telling me is true. I know that you're suffering right now, but I've got to take this stack, I've got to take this paper down to this office and then let it sit there for a while. I'm not blaming anyone, I'm blaming the process. However, the process works more effective when those individuals, and you have a few, there are some people who are working in agencies right now, Department of Human Services, child care, look, there are some working in Social Security, in Medicaid, who really, really, really do understand what Rip Daniels is saying when it comes to, well, there are some people whose lives are hanging in the balance over a signature. Well, I took it down there to the administrator, and oh, that's my job, I just leave it in, and it's just sitting there. And I understand, you've done your job, you've done your part. But it's a little bit too much to ask them. Look, these folks here, really. All these people on your desk, sir, all they need is your signature. We've vetted them, we've gone over this, come on. Get your stamp, get a signature stamp. Stamp this stuff and get it out of here. Come on. So Arthur Jones was accused of murder in Hattiesburg. He was accused of murdering Jabari Gowdy in Hattiesburg, Mississippi. A nightclub called Memories. He was in the parking lot about 2 a.m. in the morning. You know, if it's ever time to not be in a club these days, it seems like after 12. And I don't know why. It just seems like things don't get started till after 12. What are y'all waiting for? When the shooting starts? Hey, why not a happy hour at 5? Get up out of there. You know what I mean, bro? Get out by 10. Look, hey, get you a buzz, get your woman, go. Well, hey, that's when all the, I guess that's when all the shot callers and the, come out. I don't know. You go out, bro. No, yes?
Every so often, yeah.
So all the cool people come out after 12. Nobody has to come out and go out before them.
Yeah, I mean, if you come, you get your band, you leave, you come back.
Right.
Yeah.
That's when all the cool people come. And who wants to be there when most of the shootings start?
Well, no one.
Well, obviously there are those who do, because I'm going to tell you that when the shooting starts. Things have changed. Okay, I know. They've changed. No more happy hour at Saturdays. You weren't around with Saturdays.
Saturdays?
Yeah. Man, those were the days, man.
It's a place, not a time.
Well, it is a place, as it most certainly is, at the corner of Tea Garden and Highway 90, and, you know, Saturdays and T.O.'s, and, boy. You can go out at 5 o'clock and, you know.
P.M.?
Oh, yeah, 5 a.m. After work, you had to go out and get your little drink before you went home to face some kids, you know. Before you picked them up, you went out and you got a little, well, it took that, bro. You're not going to go and pick up your kids without having, getting your head right. I mean, after work, you're going through all that strain and so forth. You stop down on Saturdays and grab you a nice drink.
Take the edge off.
Oh, it rips Kumbaya, which I open. I open that up later on. And so you after dealing with people, especially in the service industry, you need something to just kind of cool out a little bit, then you can go and handle the rest of the world.
Mellow out.
Trying to soften this because this is really quite pathetic. If you have not heard this story, then you need to. Tell you what we're going to do. We're going to go to our local station, WLOX, here. And let you hear what happened to Arthur Jones.
In July of 2015, 17-year-old Jabari Gowdy's life was ended after he was shot twice outside of a club in Hattiesburg. For another young man, 70 miles away in Gulfport at the time of Gowdy's murder, a nightmare was just starting to unfold.
I was terrified the whole time, like every day, 24/7.
Arthur Jones Jr. agreed to sit down with me and recount his vivid recollections of a police encounter that nearly destroyed his life.
Majority of the time, I felt like I was going to have to go to prison for this crime that I didn't commit, because they seemed to discredit my evidence of my innocence.
Mere hours after Gowdy was gunned down, AJ was the unsuspecting target of a murder investigation. Court documents spell out the facts during and after that July 2015 shooting. AJ was one of two people picked out of a lineup by a witness at the scene. AJ voluntarily came to the Gulfport police station, waived his Miranda rights, and agreed to be interviewed. The 23-year-old was confident the evidence would show he was nowhere near Hattiesburg when the shooting took place.
I expected to immediately be released because I knew I had, you know, I had evidence, surveillance of me being in Gulfport at the time of the murder.
According to court documents, Detective Rockhold of the Hattiesburg Police Department told AJ he had video evidence of him inside Club Memories before the shooting took place, even dismissing a video Jones had on his cell phone of him inside Club Illusions in Gulfport the night of the murder.
And that's you and your cousin in there, Kate.
And that's at Club Illusions.
No, it's not.
Detective Rockhold also stated Jones' cell phone pinged in Hattiesburg on the night in question. The detective later admitted these were lies. In fact, surveillance footage from Club Illusions in Gulfport that night shows AJ at the bar multiple times just minutes before Galley was shot over an hour away in Hattiesburg. Additionally, cell phone records reveal AJ's phone, quote, never connected to or pinged a tower near the city of Hattiesburg the night of July 4th or the morning of July 5th of 2015. Tim Holloman, an attorney for Jones, says important information was also left out of the arrest warrant affidavit, the basis for the arrest warrant that was issued for Jones.
So if they had gone to the judge in this case, in AJ's case, and said, okay, Judge, we got an eyewitness that AJ did it, but Judge, 3 minutes before he said AJ did it, he identified another man. Then the judge would say, I'm sorry, I'm not finding this fellow over to the grand jury. Go back and do some more investigation. AJ stays out of jail. That's what should have happened. But in that affidavit, as the court laid out in its opinion, they omitted the truth.
AJ remained behind bars for 8 months, even after another man was arrested and investigated for the same crime. AJ bonded out on March 12th of 2016, but continued making the drive to Hattiesburg every month to meet with the probation officer. This even after the other man, Andreco Gustin, was indicted for the murder of Jabari Galdi.
I feel like I lost more than 2 years because, like I said, it's still I've been dealing with this since I was 23. I'm 29 now. So it's a lot longer than 2 years. I'm still dealing with this in search of justice, of my justice.
The actual murderer is serving a 30-year prison sentence for second-degree murder. As for Jones, it's been 6 years since he was first locked up and wrongfully accused.
You're going to jail for murder.
AJ's hope is a legal system that kept him in jail for 8 months now provides him with the retribution he's after.
The system is designed to have checks and balances. Well, when law enforcement doesn't tell the truth, the system fails. The system fails AJ because the law enforcement didn't tell the truth.
And that murder charge against AJ was not dropped until October 2017, months after Gustin was indicted by a grand jury for Galdi's death. AJ has filed suit against Detective Rockhold and the city of Hattiesburg, claiming he was falsely accused of murder in the shooting death of 17-year-old Jabari Galdi. Now, the city has been dismissed from that suit, but a trial date has been set for November the 15th in the case against Detective Rockhold. We reached out to Rockhold's attorney, who gave us this statement. Quote, we are pleased that the city of Hattiesburg has been dismissed in the lawsuit. Detective Rockhold had a very difficult case with a number of witnesses who identified Mr. Jones as the perpetrator of the crime. The detective relied on the advice of the Forest County District Attorney's Office during the course of the investigation. The evidence later revealed the identity of the person who committed the crime and who was ultimately convicted. The law protects the detective with qualified immunity, and we are confident he will be vindicated at a trial.
Should the law protect Rockhold, the detective, with qualified immunity?
I think you made a mistake that cost Jones serious time out of his life.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm here to tell you, it goes back to that shuffling of papers again. See, when you go through this and you look at when AJ was arrested, right, and accused, and by the way, Tim Holloway knows this very well. I think Tim Holloway is also the DA, advising attorney for the Harrison County Board of Supervisors. However, Which, by the way, is no big deal. It just simply says he knows. It comes down to law enforcement. Of course, he is the son of one Boyce Holloman, who was a former district attorney. You know, and then very prominent attorney here. So he knows his way around this very well. And I think AJ, for the most part, is in good hands here with this. But I want to correct him by saying it was not law enforcement that did something wrong. It was this detective. It was this detective who handled this case. And it was the DA. But it's okay to call it what it is. So often we group all of them together. Tim knows this, and we know this. It's not the police of Hattiesburg. It's this guy. It's this guy. We can be specific. How this detective handled this and how the DA handled this was completely wrong, even after knowing within a month that there was another video. All the time AJ sitting in jail. And the police just simply did not believe the video. Actually thought that the owner, he actually put forward some theories. Here's a theory that Rock Gold put forward, the detective. He actually suggested that AJ and his cousin wore the same t-shirts so they couldn't be identified. In other words, AJ was at the Club Memories there in Hattiesburg, Club Illusions, as it was called then. So they wore the same t-shirts and they looked similar, and that was just bull. Then he suggested that even the owner of Club Illusions, whom I know very well, was actually working with AJ by going in and trying to change the date. Rockhole alleged that the owner of Club Illusions and one of the security guards helped Jones plan by smuggling him back into the club. The detective cited the time clock on the surveillance video as evidence of this plan, despite testifying previously that the time clock could not be used to whether Jones was at the club or not. It's timestamped, is what it is. He just chose not to believe. I mean, there's got to be a certain amount of cynicism and distrust on the part of investigating officers and our DAs, there's no doubt. Everybody wants to get away. I mean, any criminals want to get away. But you can't ignore the evidence. But then they did something else. Didn't even provide that evidence. Didn't even provide it to the grand jury. And to come up with these theories, only because they wanted to get AJ. They wanted to get Jones. This is a prime example of getting your man instead of solving the case. I don't know what grudge there was with AJ. I have no idea. But sometimes those of you who are investigating, and those of us who make presumptions, we do it because of some grudge we have with the person rather than, well, did this really happen? Did they really do this? Detective Rockhold then told Jones that his cell phone had pinged in Hattiesburg. That was a lie. He's basically now trying to get Jones to admit it. It was a lie. I mean, can an officer do this? Yeah, they can do this. They can do it. In an effort to try to get to the truth, sometimes you tell a lie. Right, look, I don't hold that against you. However, you can't use that in testimony. You can't go to a grand jury with that kind of information. You just can't.
False information.
Well, it is. You're not supposed to do that. I mean, it's one thing if you're doing an interrogation and you're trying to get someone to fess up. You can use those tools, but to actually perpetuate that. Not that Rock Gold did that. Because the court documents actually showed that the detective would not finally admitted that he lied. That it didn't ping. He just did that to try to get something to happen. Now, hang on, folks. You got to understand what's happening here. In the LaMelo case and other cases, there is an army of individuals who are handling this case while handling other cases. And there are procedures that you follow. The travesty of this is first that A.J. Jones spent one day in jail, which for a crime he didn't commit. The man was arrested, July 15th. July 15th. Well, Jabari was killed July 15th. Let's say AJ. AJ. Let's see. They went through the identification process of the other individual that was with Jabari, could not really identify who had shot Jabari. AJ, who had shot Jabari. Hawk could not identify who was actually in the car. He identified several different people and changed his mind on several different occasions. I can understand that. I really can. There was an understation. There was a situation involving yours truly where I caught these two individuals trying to break in a place and held them at gunpoint, and I went to identify these individuals after they were caught. And it was very difficult. And because I identified one as being the person and the other as being the driver, and then the next time I identified the driver as being the person that had the goods. Well, as it turns out, it was easy for me to get that confused. You know why?
Why?
It was father and son. And I knew these people too, by the way, folks. It was so funny. The detective looked at me and said, well, you're ripped. Now you realize you just identified this guy as being that guy, the driver, and now you say this guy was the driver. You know, do you really know? And then, of course, later after I went through that a time or two, he finally confessed to me. He said, well, you know what? They were father and son. They looked very similar. That was not the case here, however. Jones did not look like the man who ultimately was convicted of murder. Not even close.
And that was on July 5th of 2015. It was just a few days later when Jones was picked up.
Hmm. So it happened on that 4th, right? It happened on the 4th. And so Jones was picked up erroneously. Now, let me just tell you, for those of you who think that this is just, you know, law enforcement doing their job, and they are, you have any idea what it's like to have your life completely interrupted by something that you know you didn't do? Now, hang on. Whatever Jones was going to do that day didn't get done. If he had a job, had to pick the kids up, had whatever. Don't just shine it on as if, okay, well, you know, they're just trying to do their job. You're right. You're absolutely right. However, don't also just take for granted that decent law-abiding citizens, and by the way, Jones called in. He called the Gulfport PD, and they've been putting stuff on social media. There were those who erroneously said they could identify him there, and so law enforcement was going to do what law enforcement do. So, man, come on, was it you? And they're going to, obviously, you know, at the very least, with enough information, go out and do the interview. And which they did. Jones said he wasn't there. Had an alibi. Told him, go check the video. All of that. Wasn't necessary. They're going to arrest him because, after all, this was cold-blooded shooting of Jabari. No doubt it was. And they've got to get their man. And we want to make sure that Jones doesn't go anywhere, so we're going to go ahead and arrest him, at least hold him for 24 hours or 36 hours. While we try to build a case against the guy we want to get rather than solve the case. So there he sat, Jones. Sat for almost 6 months. And then, ladies and gentlemen, after knowing that the girlfriend that was in the car of the perpetrator, after she had told him, whoa, wait a minute, this, Andrico Gaston did it. And the girl took a polygraph test. Didn't matter. To Detective Rockhold, he let everybody else go and kept Jones. And ladies and gentlemen, didn't even stop there. You gotta understand. Even after this, after they went through, arrested Gaston, you had Jones still with the murder charge hanging over his head. He was given bail, but still had a murder charge on his head. Don't just think like, okay, that's just, I'm on here, look, that's just preliminary. Someone's life is interrupted. In other words, yeah, the police are doing their job, but I have a job to do too, right? Makes me wonder just how many of the people, and I know quite a few who have gone this route, and I have shared with many law enforcement officers, and And actually, clerks and a few judges, hey man, look, well, what are we gonna do here? You're doing your job, you're fine, but you go home to your family, and then you've got someone who's sitting there with their lives hanging in the balance because you think he did it. Or you know he didn't do it, but we've got to let the paperwork be shifted down to the office. I can't sound off on this, Rip. I can't let them out. It's going to take the sheriff to do that. It's going to take the judge to do that. I can't do it. I didn't put in my 8 hours, Rip. It's 5 o'clock. I've got to go home to my kids. Yeah, I know he shouldn't be in here, but he could sit in there another day. This is the mindset that you have from some people who don't see the humanity. And look, I know, you know, you can't force your supervisors to do. I know that. However, you have got to report any supervisor who would just negligently allow someone who they know doesn't belong there to be there, bro. That's taxpayer money being wasted. If for no other reason than that. And then there's the risk of this individual, AJ, not making it out. I mean, trust me, you got the worst of the worst in the Hansburg jail. But there's just no sense of urgency. I mean, does the process work? Yes, it works. And Tim was right. When you do the right thing, yes. When people who are not supposed to lie don't lie, yeah, it works. But it's got to be timely. There's got to be some desire to say, okay, wait a minute, we got this wrong. And once you know you got it wrong, then that needs to be Godspeed. There's been no settlement. Hattiesburg is off the hook. Now a court case has been set in November to see whether or not his lawsuit, civil lawsuit, against the detective is going to go forward. Guarantee the detective has little nothing, not nearly as much as Hattiesburg. There's some tort things, though, that maybe Tim and Jones could come up with. $250,000, maybe, I don't know. However, the attorney for the officer very rightly is saying, well, he's got qualified immunity, and he does. He got it wrong, okay. There's some negligence there, but, you know, come on, Jones is out, get over it. Don't look a gift horse in the mouth, they'd say to Jones. It's incredible. So the charges were dropped for the five people who were initially charged in connection with Gowdy's murder, but Jones remained charged with murder until October 10th, 2017. Now you understand, March, this guy, Andrico Gaston, was indicted for the murder of Gowdy and ultimately was convicted. Detective Rockhold said he thought that Jones would have received a no true bill from the grand jury. Well, they didn't because they didn't have the evidence. They could have gotten it. But Detective Rockhold just wanted to hold like a rock. Jones. It wasn't until Jones filed a lawsuit against the city and the Detective Rockhold that he learned no true bill had been issued and that Jones was still charged with murder. So there was no indictment, but still the charges was on Jones. I don't know, somebody dropped the ball. That's the paper. Here's the paper. This is Jones's paper. Here's his file. I set it over there. I forgot all about it. Sorry. You think Jones is due?
Absolutely.
Let us know on the Facebook page. This is not all. I've got a whole bunch here. There is a question now as to what statue is going to replace the Confederate a-holes who was there in the Capitol. By the way, the only congressman of Mississippi that voted to remove them was one congressman, Benny Thompson. The others wanted the statues to stay there, that of the only president of the Confederacy and the person who actually signed the secession papers that were penned by L.Q.C. Lamar. By the way, his building's been torn down at Ole Miss. L.Q.C. Lamar, the Supreme Court Justice, who was around, of course, back during when the Civil War first began, 1861. So the person who signed those papers there, the big signature from one, James Zachariah George. That's the first time ever hearing of the guy. His statue was there. His bust is there, too.
You gotta go, too.
So who do you think? Who do you think those two statues should be replaced by? Those individuals who really represented one Magnolia State of Mississippi family. We'll be back.
To be safe around electricity, here are a few things to be aware of. Electricity from power lines can jump to